The number one question that we get over and over again is, what do you wish you had known before you made the shift to off-grid living? And some people are asking that because they are maybe thinking about living off-grid themselves and they want to be well prepared. And some people are asking that just because they want to know, because it's an interesting thing to find out what is different, what feels different, and what are the things that we didn't know. So we're going to show you the 10 things that we wish we had known before we went off the grid. Here we go.
Solar power is easier than you think. It took me a long time to get comfortable with the idea of all of these different solar components, and it was all so confusing. But there's a lot of good literature out there that kind of simplifies it, and you're not going to get it horribly wrong. There might be inefficiencies in your system, but it's going to work. Not no matter what you do, but you can do a lot of different combinations of things and still get solar power, still have a battery bank that will charge your devices and do the bare minimum of what you need. Because after you've lived without power at all for a while, your needs are really pretty low. So any amount of solar power is worth doing.
Plants can't grow where there's no soil. So we got a great piece of land, but we got a great piece of land where the soil was not rich and prepared for farming. We wasted some time our first year trying to grow plants in the soil without realizing that our first job was to create soil. So we have a number of ways of doing that, just bringing in any kind of organic matter from various kinds of manure to grass clippings or leaves. We now use a chicken tractor to use our chicken manure to really create soil, even right in the middle of our garden plot where we just had clay dry soil before. We do a lot of sheet mulching, and we're building our earth so that when we plant the plants in them, they'll actually grow.
Water runs downhill. Maybe you knew that already.
So we have a spring that's up the hill from where we set up our yurt, and it took us a long time to figure out a really easy way to get pressurized water. Well, that water source is above where we want to use water. So why not just hook it up? The moral of that story is gravity-fed water systems are a lot easier than you think. And it's just worth hooking it up and experimenting and seeing what it's able to do. In our case, it's able to actually run a small water heater and run our sink and pretty much everything else that we need to do.
All that matters because carrying water is the worst. The literal worst. Carrying water is so bad, in fact, that we aren't going to demonstrate it for you. We carry our water in 5-gallon buckets all winter long. This will be our third winter of doing that, and if all goes according to our very, very detailed and careful plan, this is our last winter of it. And that's good because it's back-breaking labor. We carry our water down from the spring all winter long in containers like this one. Can you see that? It's a 5-gallon container. And we do have a sled. We do have ways to bring it down the hill that make it easier. But it's pretty demoralizing to carry water. So I would say we knew that it was going to be hard, but we didn't actually realize how hard it was going to be. Any way that you can get around that by creating plumbing systems and even doing the hard work of digging your plumbing underground so that it won't freeze is completely worth it.
Batteries run out. LED lights are a really efficient way to go. The bulb that we put in our new light fixture is a 60 watt equivalent, but it only draws 9.5 watts, which just barely sips off of our little battery bank. So that beats the crap out of the battery powered camp lantern that we used for so long. Also, we now have rechargeable headlamps. These are expensive, but they will never go bad. So instead of buying a whole bunch of AAA batteries all the time and throwing them out, we just plug these in and recharge them.
Bears like trash. Okay, so we already knew that before we moved out here, technically. But I think we didn't realize what a priority that was. When we had a bear come and visit us, we had created conditions that were ideal for a bear to move in. And he was with us for a couple of days, and it was not a safe situation for me or for my kids. So if you're thinking, well, I know that bears like trash, but I think it's more important for me to do X, Y, and Z than it is to secure my trash in an area where a bear might pass through, I suggest that you reconsider those priorities. We have secured our trash, and since then, it's very possible that a bear ambles through now and then, but there's no reason for him to stay, or her to stay. There's no reason for them to hang out and move in, and we sure are safer and happier because of it.
Firewood is a ton of work. So every year we have to fill this woodshed. It takes about 5 cords of wood or so to get us through the winter. And that's a lot of work, getting it all over here and split and cut into the right shape and size, and making sure it's all dry and actually useful as firewood. So far we've been able to get by on limbs from trees that we cut down for lumber and offcuts of lumber, and not really cutting down a whole ton of trees just for firewood, but it's still a lot of work to get it over here. The long-term plan is to do a rocket mass heater for the house, and we would have liked to do one for the yurt as well. It is a huge savings on the amount of firewood that you go through. So anything that you can do to increase the efficiency of burning wood for heat and for cooking, do it, because creating that fuel is just, it's a lot more work than you want to be doing.
Yurts are better at cold weather than they are at hot weather. We were psychologically prepared for the winter to be difficult in our half home, half tent yurt, but we underestimated the kind of brilliant design of a yurt. If it's insulated, it holds heat very, very well. And we also underestimated the extent to which hot air would be trapped in the summertime. So that became a solution that needed to be found in the summer months. We installed a fan. And this also has to do with our particular design of the yurt, that we don't have a large opening at the top, and we were concentrating on keeping heat in. But we solved that problem with a solar-powered fan in the top of the yurt. And now our summers are as comfortable as our winters.
Temporary is longer than you think. So our plan, before we had ever done any part of living off the grid, was to be in the yurt for a year. Well, it's going to be at least 3 years before we have our house habitable. So I guess the takeaway from that is you just don't know until you're doing it. So if you are setting up a temporary situation, you might as well make it comfortable enough to be in for a while, because you just don't know how long it's going to take to get everything done. And also, you just have to, the ambitious planner part of you has to be kind to the part of you that actually has to live through it.
You can do things you didn't know you could do. So I guess the moral is that you can teach an old dog new tricks.
I'm the old dog.
We're doing okay. We're doing fine. We've learned a lot and we're still learning. But an attitude of learning and an attitude of being okay with accepting that the lessons that we need to learn are sometimes kind of elementary is allowing us to make the changes that we have always dreamed of making.
And it's all right there in front of you. And you just got to pay attention and react and not be afraid. And look, nobody's died so far.
So I hope you're getting our little joke here, which is that a lot of the things that we needed to know, we actually really did know.
Maybe we didn't know we knew them, or we didn't have the courage to act on them. But a lot of the things that you need to know to create alternative lifestyle, you've already got. So if you're making a shift like this, we wish you luck. Have a great time.